Hi again. So last time we made a very, very simple system that uses two points, draws a line between them, and creates a pendulum. So that was this. Now this time we're going to create a slightly more complex system, still built on lines. We're going to create a catenary. So what a catenary is, it's the curve that an idealized hanging chain makes under its own weight when it hangs. And in architecture, this is quite an important curve because it indicates the ideal distribution of compression forces or tension forces. So if last time we were working with a single length, so let's get rid of these. And last time we were working with a single line, what we want to do now is create a segmented chain of lines. So let's just pause this. And we're going to take this line and subdivide it. So let's start with relatively few segments so we can see how this works. So if what we did last time was have a single line and either of its ends anchored, we're going to have these work as a chain. So using all of these points, we're going to break up our line. And this is going to give us all of the different segments as lines. And instead of inputting one line into this length component, we're going to input all of these. And we're going to keep everything the same for now. So remember that this reads the length of all of these, and it can give a factor that's going to say how long you want them to be eventually. So if we have a multiplier of 1, all of these lines are going to want to remain the same length. Now, because in a chain, weight is applied to all parts of the string, we're going to use these points as the points for applying our downward force, which we had set up from last lesson as well. And at the moment, we've got one anchor point set, which is the start. And so what's going to happen if we just run this? It's going to fall kind of like a rubber band. And this is because you wouldn't expect parts of a chain to start to stretch like this. And then that's where the strength of each of these forces comes into play. So for example, these forces, which are the ones that are trying to maintain the length of these sections, they're not as strong as the force that's trying to pull everything down. Consequently, they stretch. So if you take this strength and set something really high, at the moment, it's 1. and set this to be something pretty high. Whoops. And when you make changes like this, you have to kind of test it out to see what the effect is. Now the effect is that the vertical force is really, really low. So let's not go so insane, and maybe 1,000. Or even less. So that's falling pretty much like a chain would. All the segments are maintaining their length. Now, what's going to happen if we anchor both of these ends? So I'm just going to add this to our list of anchors. That's the other end. And what you'll see is this will simulate the catenary curve when a chain sags. And you can increase the length of all of these parts, the segments. And you can use that to increase the height of this catenary curve. Now, what you can also do is increase the number of segments, because if you want to get a really smooth representation of what this curve would be, using less segments will give you a rougher approximation of what the curve is. So, actually, this is a really important part of a concept in simulating these types of shapes, which is the more segments of geometry you have, the smoother and more accurate the representation is going to be. And that's just about a case of resolution in the system. So if we increase this to 40, it goes crazy. Because when you make some changes, it kind of throws off all the system. So now you just have to restart it. And that's creating your hanging chain. And you can measure the length of all of these segments that result, and they come out of here. So just get all of the lengths. Of the lines that are output from here. You might want to get rid of the nulls. And you can do that using the clean tree component. And you want to have very, very little variation between these if you want to have a correct representation of a catenary curve. So, if you want to make this a better model, then you can see that the segments are stretching a bit. And you might want to increase the strength of the line forces. So they're very rigidly tied to the shape they're supposed to be. And also at this point, you might be wondering whether you really have to, you know, wait for kind of this very slow calculation. And in fact, you don't. Because this solver, we're still not going to use the non-bouncy solver, because we want to see how the forces are playing out. But for now, when you use this, the bouncy solver, which keeps momentum, you can choose how many iterations. And we changed this in the first lesson. And we can change it to 10. And if you restart this, you can see that should give you a faster animation. Okay, so if you want to, instead of creating a sagging chain in tension, you want to create a perfect arch, you would just have to reverse the force applied to all of these to go up. Because if you've ever looked at stuff like Gaudi's drawings, you'll see that an arch is basically just the upside down shape of a sagging chain. So it's this simple to create. And again, the more resolution you put into this, the better the representation. So you could go for 100 here. And again, restart this. And have a very, very smooth representation. What you could also do is say, play around with this, maybe extract one of these points. Maybe the one of these that's here. So these are going to be in the original line, which I've hidden. So one of these, and anchor that as well. Just hide that. And see what happens. Maybe also add another one. And so you can see how we're using the exact same, well, almost the exact same components as we did last time, and just divide this for clarity. And we're still just using basic vector force components. We're still using anchor points, and we're still using just line length forces. But we're creating a more complex system with more elements, and we can do much more than just a pendulum this time. So what we're going to do next time is we're going to take this into 3D and see how we can create these types of shapes with a net and start to create these vaulted surfaces and also tensile membrane structures. So that's going to be the next lesson.